Welcome to the war room. We got Dez, Kill, Jimmy, PJ, B. Austin, the Hot Block Commander.
How you wanna end a 1 or 2 hour show to keep the brain running with the premise of talk sports on a national level? Roll with the topic, sort of like the rubber. When it's game time, they like the Fab Five during prime time. Sports conglomerates speak their minds a little bit. For sports medicine and sports veterans and greats, the 4 for 26 or the war ain't gonna win. It's the war room with five knights at the round table, five Philly guys diversified and educated.
Here we go. What up, War Room family? You're once again live in the War Room, brought to you by War Room Sports on the War Room Sports Podcast Network. Guy, Devin McMillan, I'm at the round. Other guys, got B. Austin, Jimmy the Blueprint to be in just a few minutes now. The first Olympiad are making way for America's latest favorite pastime, which is football. We'll wrap in last thoughts on the Olympic Games and discuss NFL storylines going into this week's dress rehearsals, a.k.a. preseason game number 3. We'll also talk with Fred Perdue in the college football segment and a whole lot more. So keep it locked right here for the next 2 hours. If you want to holler at us throughout the show, you know what to do. So just right now in the JW Philly Realty chat room at blogtalkradio.com/thewarroom. You can join us on Facebook or Twitter at War Room Sports. You can also call us directly in about 45 minutes after Fred Perdue in the college football report. That's when we're going to open up the Digital Extreme Tech line. The number is 333-410-0012. But as usual, we think you should know out on the air. Remember to check out all the great programming on the War Room Podcast Network. Aside from the War Room, you can listen to shows such as The Broad Street Line with Roy and Chris, the History and the Tape Hip Hop Show with Phil and Savide, and your favorite rapper's favorite rappers. No Look Podcast with Frank and Annie. I have first review with the mayor. Jon Appetit with the birds and a whole lot more. Just visit warroomsports.com. Click the WRS Podcast Network tab. Get yourself going. Fellas. B. Austin, what's the deal, man? What's going on with you?
Yo, man, shout out to Ryan Lochte and White Privilege, man. I salute you. Amazing story.
Hilarious story. We're going to talk a little bit about that in a few minutes. But, yeah, that story is just more amazing every time I partake in a core or something like that. Like, I just can't believe it happened. I don't know why it happened. I don't understand it. It's weird, man. Man, what's going on with me? School, brother. I got me a kindergartner up in here. First day of
kindergarten. Word.
Tuesday. Actually missed it because, you know, I was out of town business until Wednesday. But you know, the kind of pops we are. I was irking the boy and his mama. I FaceTime with him, you know, while he was riding to school and had her take pictures and videos and all that kind of stuff. I was drawn.
You was drawn. So was I. And
today, because he's been talking about this for like 3 years, like since he's been 2, he see a school bus riding down the street, and his mom would always say, well, you can't ride the school bus until you're 5. So he finally had his first school bus experience this morning. Loved it. Yeah, it's not going to be an everyday thing, but, you know, maybe once or twice a week, throw him on the school bus. I'll let him go.
Get on the school bus. How you going to take him away from the cheese bus, man? What's wrong with you?
Cheese bus schedule and my schedule don't line up right. Get him on the cheese if you want to get on the cheese. That's an experience that every person has to have in their life. If you've never been on the cheese bus, then you've been deprived. You've really been surprised.
Yeah, definitely.
I can't give you legitimate great reasons why, but you've been deprived.
Once you get to about 6th grade, then you're going to go against everything Rosa Parks fought for, and you're going to go sit in the back of the bus, and when it goes over bumps, you're going to jump as high as you possibly can. It's, of course, against the rules, but flipping over a seat in the back of a cheese bus, is an experience that every young man should have in his life, man. After a big bump, you got to flip over the, you got to flip over the sheet, man. It ain't the same if it's not. My young ones are back at it, back in school as well as of this coming Monday. So we're not quite there, but all school supplies are bought. And let me tell you, the anticipation of school, even after kindergarten, you never recreate that kindergarten moment, but it's still exciting to see the kids go back to school. I'm of course a few times in, but yeah, we going back to school this coming Monday.
That's what's up. And you know, speaking of the cheese bus, and you said, you know, the thing you got to do at least once. There's some other stuff that you know every young girl got to do on the school bus, but you got to be a little older, you know. that's at least middle school.
What's your finger? What's your finger smell like?
All righty then. That's my cue. We gonna tell you guys what happened this week while y'all were on that good grind. I mean, shout out to y'all if y'all got kids going back to school as well. I know here in Maryland they start a little early, so everybody might not be there. I think, like, in Georgia, they did this, like, 3 weeks ago, if I'm not mistaken. But while y'all
Georgia,
on the
Georgia, they just never let them out.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's good. Down there, with the stuff going on in the streets of Georgia, you probably should just keep them in school. And shout out to, speaking of Georgia, man, shout out to the rumors that Freaknik was coming back this year. I recently saw something that says that it's canceled. But they tried to revive Freaknik, one of the most ignorant, man, I'm not going to talk about Freaknik.
Don't even, they got to Google it. We can't speak on it. All I'm going to say is Uncle Luke, and you might have to Google that too.
I mean, they ain't got to Google it. I got plenty of footage at my house, you know, hidden away so the people in my house can't see it, but Freaknik 96 and 97, shout out to everybody who was down there.
Yo, golly, man. Shout out to the Greek Fest, though, too.
Yeah.
Shout out to the Philly Greek Fest, Fairmount Park. Man, go ahead, man, before we get
bring it all back. All right. While y'all on the grind, it's brought to you by DirecTV. If you like a better TV experience than cable has to offer, including that NFL Sunday ticket, you'll need that in 2 weeks. Go to our website, WarRoomSports.com. Click on the DirecTV logo. Order yourself a better TV experience at a discounted War Room Sports sign-up rate. If you call yourself a sports fan, then you gotta have DirecTV. This story, every time we talk about it, man, the Trey Mason saga, man, they talked to his mom. And I don't think this is, like, brand new this week, but the reports are just coming out this week. They talked to Trey Mason's mom. You know, he still hasn't showed up for camp. But I think this was after one of the times that he got, you know, detained by the law, and a police officer had told his mom, like, yeah, Trey needs to be playing football right now. And she was like, no, actually, he shouldn't be playing football right now, because this football, this, you know, this is the football that drives everybody and nobody even knows about. She said that concussions and head injuries currently have her son in a 10-year-old's mind state. And, you know, when we talk about his arrest and his not showing up and him just being missing, you know, we discuss mental health and all of that. And his mom is saying that football has a direct effect on his mental health, and concussions have basically done this young brother in, man. Shout out to Plug 4, man. Yo, what's your thoughts on that?
Yo, I ain't going to lie to you. The three of us have our ignorant moments. You know, Jimmy and I probably more so than you, but we all have our ignorant moments and our ignorant things to say. But this right here, man, I don't know why, and I don't even know how. This joint almost made me cry, man. I don't know Trey Mason. I've never even seen him play. I've seen some highlights. I don't have any ties to Trey Mason. I really shouldn't even care about the brother other than being a human being. But this just, yo, this just made me cry, man, almost. It didn't really. Because, you know, karate man cry on the inside. this was because you got to understand, man, this brother is like 20 years old, 21, 22. He shouldn't be facing this until he's in his 90s, if ever. His brain is scrambled, cuz. His brain is scrambled.
I mean, and we're still in a holding pattern. Like, I haven't watched – I've seen one episode of Hard Knocks with the Rams. So I haven't seen – in that one episode, you know, they didn't mention anything about Trey Mason not being there. Shout out to Hank of Imaginary Players. I was talking to him, and he said that they haven't mentioned anything about it on the show. He was kind of wondering why they weren't addressing it. I'm not in misunderstanding of why they're not addressing it. I mean, real talk. Like, he's not there. They're not going to talk about it. You know, Trey Mason is not as if Todd Gurley is, you know, holding out and nobody's heard from him. So, you know, it's not a topic popular enough to be featured on that show. So I really have no questions about why they're not doing it. But, you know, training camp, we're going into dress rehearsals this week, and he has had no contact with the team since last off season. So I don't even know what the Rams are doing about his situation. But yeah, this is sad, man.
My man got scrambled eggs for brain, and I'm thinking about my son, who is a highly intelligent 8-year-old, and I'm just trying to pattern, you know, think about a grown-ass 20-some-year-old man acting like my son. Right. And I'm like, yo, I can't. Something almost brought a tear to my eye, and it goes back to, you know, how we grew up where football, even still to this day, football is such an integral part of our lives, and it's what we do within the context of sports media. But it's like, man, all of the people that are saying that this is not what human beings should be doing, like, I'm secretly and quietly, I have no argument for them. I have no argument. As much as I love the game and I love the sport, my son's mother says, my wife says, he will not be playing, and I can't muster up in my spirit the wherewithal to argue back. I mean, intellectually, I can argue back, and I can make a great case for why our son should play. But,
right,
like, in my heart of hearts, like, I don't have no argument. I don't have no counter for that. You know,
right.
I just have only to look at Trey Mason.
So shout out to Trey Mason, man. I hope things get better for the young brother. I hope what he's dealing with is not what, you know, we think it could be this early. But if it is, man, football is just going to be another blow for the game in general. Speaking of somebody else with a famous father, the son of our spiritual leader, the son of one of our favorite players of all time, one of the top two or three defensive players of all time, Ray Lewis III, who was a former player himself at the University of Miami and Coastal Carolina. We talked about this back in, it was either March or May, one of those M months, where he was brought up on charges for sexual assault of an 18-year-old girl. Well, this week, an indictment has come down in this case, and the indictment is basically sexual battery of an 18-year-old female who was incapacitated due to the use of drugs or alcohol. He was released on $10,000 bond after turning himself in. The indictment states that 20-year-old Lewis sexually assaulted the victim when he knew or had a reason to know that the victim was mentally defective, mentally incapacitated, or physically helpless. of course, he's saying that the sex was, you know, his lawyer is saying that the sex was 100% consensual, and apparently it was sex with her and another female. There's only one that's bringing up rape charges. It's just crazy. I mean, he's no longer at the school, Coastal Carolina, as a player or a student. Thoughts on this, man, because we're seeing this a lot lately. I mean, this is nothing new. You know, sexual assault goes on every day, you know, probably thousands of times a day just in this country alone. But we're seeing higher profile people, you know, go through this.
My question is, and this, you know, it goes in several directions. You know, rape, sexual assault, sexual battery, these are certainly not new things. It's age old, unfortunately. It's sickening. It's disgusting. You have to ask yourselves, in the worst definitions of these crimes, do you cats have moms, mothers, sisters, daughters? Right. So here's what I've noticed. As of late, more and more of these cases are involving outside substances. More and more of these cases are involving, you know, drugs being introduced and the person being incapacitated.
Exactly.
Is that
I was going to bring up.
And then in this particular case, I don't, you know, I'm very wary about bringing the benefit of the doubt around because I always want to be sensitive to the victim, you know, and the alleged victim. I have daughters, I have a mother, aunties, cousins, I have women in my life, and it doesn't even take women in your life, just a general, you know, being a good human being and understanding that you have women out here that as a man you should have a level of honor and respect for. So I certainly have that, you know, that's my position. But I when you tell me that there's another female there and there's two, was she his accomplice in this? Were they having, you know, menage, you know, threesome? I mean, the other person being there puts a completely different spin on this for me. I mean, I need to understand what that other person was doing there and what their position is and how, you know, it could well be that she was a part of it and she's guilty, but it doesn't seem like charges are being brought up against her. So what
I mean,
really
she could not been. She could have just been there. I mean, you've been there before. I'm pretty sure you slam dance with other people around.
Yeah, it said the thing that I read says the alleged victim and another woman present were fully conscious. That's what he's saying. That's what he's alleging. So I didn't necessarily say that he, you know, he did anything with the other person, but there was someone else present.
Okay.
So she's gonna be a material witness somehow. I mean, he probably
I think this is all Ray Lewis's fault. It's like, no, I'm joking. But there's a couple ways to look at this, right? Because we see more of this being reported, which could be a good thing, right? Because we've always heard about how many cases of sexual assault go unreported,
mm-hmm.
but it's being reported
mm-hmm.
at a higher rate,
mm-hmm.
which could be a good thing, which could lead to people realizing that this is not a joke and not to be played with. You know, so that's one way to look at it. Another way to look at it is that, it's easy to railroad people. That sexual assault and rape are so, it's a tough thing to talk about. But like you said, a lot of this now is
right.
drug-related, you know, the Cosby stuff. So, women, be careful out there, man, because cats are out there trying to, like, you know, out there trying to, you know what I mean? But, and you do,
Jim.
Man, yo. Yams are at an all-time low right now. Why are you taking – you didn't get – yams are free.
See, but I think because you said it's a tough thing to talk – it definitely is a tough thing to talk about. And I think the toughest part of discussing these type of things is the fact that it's not popular to even, you know, discuss the other side of things. You know what I'm saying? Because as soon as
Listen,
we say,
man.
Well, maybe – you know, this was what he's saying. You know, the first time you say something like that, you're going to be accused of victim blaming or something like that. But, you know, a lot of things go on where sometimes it is the other way around. But
no,
the common
absolutely.
Denominator in all of this stuff lately has been the drugs. So you just have to be smarter. Like, yo, if you're doing drugs and you're drinking with somebody, it can't lead to what you want it to lead to because,
yo,
if you're not nice enough to get it sober, then you shouldn't get it because this can happen.
Yeah, yo.
This
I'm,
can happen.
I
had a rule.
We're all,
that was my rule.
Oh, yes.
I ain't
yeah,
no drunk,
I know
job.
We're all.
I can't claim
we're
that
all
role,
the same. We all cut from a similar cloth in that there was no issue in undergraduate, I'm sure graduate either, in yam farming. Like, I don't understand how these dudes are in need of implements and tools to get what, you know, it used to be fun to get to the, you know what I mean?
Right,
like,
right.
Yo, I don't.
But no, yeah,
I know
that was definitely.
It's like
definitely
back in
my
the day,
rule.
The fun was the chase, you know what I'm saying? Like trying to like, yo, you know what I mean? Like
the conquer,
you
yeah, like
somebody's
you know.
Trying to drug their ass up. But exactly.
Yo.
You're right.
Hey, but Jim, besides the rule though, you know, it was college, so you probably come close to that rule more times than not. But I was also a great videographer back then. So, you know, yo, Rake, Sean the Tape,
no
playing my part.
Right, right.
Shout out to him.
Yo, no comment.
Yo, Rake, Sean the
Tape. No
comment. Yo.
No comment. All I'm going to say is this, man. Like, you know what I'm saying? You know, I still got some stuff. I digitized some things just for my collection. But anyway, with all that being said.
Yo,
just playing his part, man. Just playing this part.
Oh, with all that being said, Dev made a good point, right? The point that, you know, things do happen. I've literally sat there and seen it happen on the other side where women cry for no reason. Where I was sitting outside with my homie and this chick, and you know what I mean? She had just came through, you know what I'm saying? Babysat a little bit, you know what I mean? For those who touch that, that's, you know what I mean? But anyway, so she's sitting there. And, you know, just chopping it up with a bunch of it. We're talking, everything's fine. And she realized what time it was, and she was late. And this is via teenagers, and her parents, you know, were kind of strict. So she cried, you know what I mean, sexual assault, just to avoid punishment from her parents. Now,
yo,
wow.
I've seen the same thing, man.
Yo,
this is what happened in
thing,
the city, man.
So the cops come down the block, lock my mans up. But then, like, you know, when they interrogated her, it came out that she was lying. Because she didn't think it would go that far. But the fact of the matter is she lied. Like, you know what I mean? It was witnesses like, yeah, she was chewing. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, she already babysat.
But you can't do that, though. Because even if something like that happens and a dude is exonerated, like, some people are just going to be critical either way. You know what I mean? Just because you had that charge brought up on you. And some people are going to look at you crooked for the rest of your life because somebody decided that they didn't want to get in trouble, so they throw your name under some serious stuff. Like, yo, you can't do that. You can't play with dudes. And dudes, you can't rape chicks. So, you know, both sides. There's something there.
Yep.
But like I said, it's always a little contentious when you even bring up the other side because, you know, it's become such a taboo subject.
My rule was a little different in undergrad, Dev. As a drunk or under the influence of the sticky icky, I would only talk to sober women. So
I was
about
to say,
I thought
you was about to say you had a breath alcohol, John, that the cops got breath alcohol test, whatever you call it. I thought you had them blow before you. Well, you probably did. But
I did.
The others.
Yo. Yo. All I'm gonna say is
the breathalyzer. The breathalyzer.
I would hashtag Jason Wilkes.
Not the fertilizer. The breathalyzer.
I would hashtag Jason Wilkes. So I didn't have any of them rules, but I'm actually very thankful when I see certain situations. I'm like, man, I'm lucky because, you know, it's been situations where I've never taken yam. It's just too easy to get it for free. But in situations where someone would have said that, then, you know what I mean? You could have been like,
sometimes what you going to do about it? Because a lot of times it's your word against hers. And if you're not famous, rich, and got lawyers, that's your ass.
That's when you make sure that you have plenty of witnesses around, as Jimmy alluded to earlier. Hopefully they're participating and they're all of the same sex.
Yo.
You know, so if
yo,
they're
Rick,
all like her,
the
then she can't. There it is.
Playing my part.
There it is.
Yo, shout out to
there
the Super Cross team. Real quick. You want to send them a shout out? You know, hold your head.
Yo, shout out to shout out to Orgies.
Yo.
Yo.
All right. I don't know where that came from. All right, we got to start. I want to ask you, brother, the question. When you're rich and famous, say you're rich and famous and you just happen to have, let's say, a half-brother that you either never met or you just, you know, was never a part of your life, like, is there an obligation to take care of somebody who's a sibling, you know, no matter what, or... You know, whatever is happening in their life, is it on their, or are they on their own?
For me, there is, but I can completely understand how someone else may not view it as such.
Well,
I mean,
for the people
I'm
who don't know, there's a story that, hold up, there's a story that LeBron James, you know, as he's signing his $100 million deals and getting rich beyond control, he has a half-brother who lives also in Ohio who's kind of living in poverty. I'm reading the story, and by the account of the writer of this particular blog, who kind of seemed a little anti-LeBron, even if you look at some other links on their blog, it seems like LeBron is not their favorite person. So this could be spun in a certain way. Yeah, by all accounts, this dude actually works in a church. You know, he's not like a bad guy, thug, or anything like that. Has a kid that he's just trying to take care of, but is definitely falling on hard times like many people in that city. The only problem is, like you said, he's a half-brother. He's the kid of LeBron James's dad, and he's a kid who was born after LeBron. So basically, he and LeBron's mom didn't work out for whatever reason, and he went and had another kid. So, you know, that could be a part of it right there. Like, if you're upset at your dad, you might take that out on any siblings you might have from here on out. Jim, what's your thoughts? You think there's any obligation on LeBron's part? Because I can't even say obligation, because you could do what you want with your money. But do you think he looks like a scumbag for not doing anything for this guy? And
not at all.
He doesn't even want that. He just wants to have a relationship with his brother.
Not at all. Not at all. I don't think he owes him anything. Bull's a grown-ass man. He's a grown-ass man. Like, they have no relationship, man. In the words of the great philosopher Dwight Grant, just because you're a relative doesn't mean you're family.
Relative is not family.
Just because you're a relative doesn't mean you're family. So, therefore, that's his relative. That's his brother. He knows nothing about him, has never had a relationship with him. I mean, because at what point does it stop? Suppose his pop had 10 other people. You know what I'm saying? So I don't think he owes him anything. If he wanted to, that'd be a solid, but I don't think he owes him anything.
What about a relationship, though? If dude is genuine and saying he just wants a relationship with the dude, he ain't got to give me money or anything. Like, if you just want to know the cat, there's no harm in that, right?
There's no harm in that, but if I feel like I don't want to know you, then, you know what I mean, deal with it. Like, there's no obligation for me to just start knowing you. Like, I got family members right now. Excuse me. I have relatives right now that I know and whatever, and I don't want to see them. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so I ain't with that, man. Listen, y'all grown men at this point, man.
All right, I feel you. No, I mean, because, you know, media outlets, blogs, whoever report stuff like this, you know, they have a way of making you seem a little scumbaggish for doing that kind of stuff. And when you make the kind of money LeBron does, you know, you make it, it looks that much worse. You know what I'm saying? But at the same time, like we said, this is not a brother that he grew up in the house with and helped him, you know, shooting with him in the gym and all that kind of stuff. So I can understand, like, without saying it in a way that just sounds terrible, I can understand. Like, so the person that's writing this is definitely trying to get in the reader's minds and put a slant on it. And I'm sure a lot of people are reading it like, oh, LeBron a scumbag and blah, blah, blah. But, you know, in a less abrasive way, I think I agree with what Jimmy's saying. In a less abrasive way.
You know what I mean?
My
thing is like,
Kobe about to lose 150 M's. Kobe my nigga, I hate it, had to be him. Bitch, you wasn't with me shooting in the gym.
Huh. Bitch, you wasn't with me shooting in the gym.
Speaking of Kobe, shout out to Kobe because the city of Los Angeles. I really do think, like, America overdoes it with sports because we just talked about the same thing in San Antonio with Tim Duncan. The city of Los Angeles has declared Kobe Bryant Day, so they had him down at City Hall, thousands of people blumpkinizing him, you know, like they've done for 20 years in the city. it's weird, especially in a city like that, like a city as big as L.A., a city where they've had great athletes in the past. He attended with his children and his pregnant wife. I mean, he did play his whole 20-year career there. He's one of the greatest Lakers of all time. Heard somebody on television today say he was the greatest Laker of all time. But, you know, I don't – like, the consensus will never be in favor of that because, you know, a lot of us do live in the past, and we're just not going to let that be the case, even if there is a case to be made. A lot of Lakers fans probably not trying to hear that. I mean, a lot of them probably are, though, because a lot of fans do live in the moment. But as soon as dude said that, everybody else on the panel was like, oh, no, hell no, hell no. And, you know, Magic's name.
Who they think it is? Norm Nixon?
Kareem's name came up. Magic's name came up first. I mean, the general consensus
reason,
is that Magic is the greatest Laker
saying,
of all time.
Saying the greatest Laker is not talking about whether he's the better basketball player. But Magic, like,
definitely not.
Yeah, Magic carried the Laker torch, like actually, to be honest with you, Magic carried it kind of foolish. Like, he had ownership stake when he played. Like, Magic was Mr. Laker. Like, you know, he was the company man, to be honest with you, if you want to keep it a buck. So Magic carried the Laker flag in a way that no other Laker has. I mean, yo, Magic wouldn't even think about being traded from the Lakers, even when they gutted the team. Like, he just, that's just what he was.
Magic, listen. The bottom line is Magic did that deal with Shaitan and gave up his firstborn son in order to be Mr. Lakers. So
he gave up the wrong son.
Secondborn son.
Magic left the Laker brand unlike any other athlete, including Kareem.
True. He just repped.
I mean, and to this day, he still does. Like, Kobe, if you look at Kobe's social media, the day he retired, he ripped everything Lakers off of everything. All his stuff now is Kobe Bryant Inc. He doesn't even have any, like, basketball, anything on his jaw. And his thing, like, Kobe just was a great player who played for the Lakers. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, he doesn't.
Speaking of Kobe Bryant Inc., also want to give him a shout out for the announcement of his $100 million venture capitalist fund. He and his partner. What's the dude's name? Stiebel. I forgot his first name. Oh, Jeff Stiebel. They actually co-founded this a while ago, but he just wanted to keep it under wraps until his plan career was over. So, yo, venture
like
capital, that's a hell of a fund, man. $100 million. You know, so they're basically going to be investing in tech companies and things of that nature. Remember, we talked about Nas doing something similar, Carmelo Anthony doing something similar. So, yo, these dudes are putting their money to use, and there's going to be a lot of rich, former athletes and entertainers in the coming years, at least, you know, the smart ones, who are just not worried about blowing money fast. So, shout out to Kobe for this. This is, you know, one of those.
When y'all get a chance, though, go to Kobe's Twitter or his Instagram or anything, and look, it don't even say retired basketball. Nothing about basketball at all. I'm like, yo,
he's moved on to the next stage.
He's completely moved on. And thinking about how he was as a player, that's probably just his personality. Like, he got a little bit of the Doc Bay in him. You know how Doc Bay finds something.
Whatever he does, that's what he's about. And he's going hard 600% at what he's doing. Nothing else matters. So,
shout out to Dr. Akil Bay. Shout out to him.
On a team one day him and LeBron should just go 50-50 on a team. Everybody tried to make them like enemies and rivals all these years. They should go 50-50 on a team. But yeah, they might be able to by that time. It's gonna 50-50.
Yo, LeBron got another TV show. Y'all see that?
What's it called? Because I thought I heard something about that. But...
it's like something about Hustle Land, something like that.
Okay.
It's about
the one he already have is one of the best on TV, but I couldn't even admit I couldn't even admit that when the homie Robert Merlin came to the page talking about how good the show was, because you know the only reason
he didn't watch it.
Shout out, to Rob Moreland, man.
Yo, that's low key one of my favorite shows. But I got a question for you, there. You don't even like to ask this to. Like, if I gave you a versus of Survivor's Remorse and Ballers, which one would you choose?
Survivor's Remorse or Ballers?
Yeah.
Man, that's two good shows, but I don't know. I still think Survivor's Remorse is more entertaining for me.
Yeah, I mean, even at the uncle. No, let me shut up. I don't want to ruin the show for anybody.
Oh yeah, yeah. He did take that elbow smash. All right, so that's what happened this week while you're on the ground. I'm going to give the birthday shout-outs real quick because we are real late. I know Fred Perdue is on the line. Like, here y'all go again. Birthdays, as usual, are brought to you by Digital Extreme Technologies. Do you or your business need a custom website? Well, for dynamic, professional, and most of all, affordable custom website solutions, you need Digital Extreme Technologies. No need to break the bank for an effective online presence. Top quality results driven websites at incredibly affordable prices. And yes, financing options are available. You can put something on it, so just visit digitalextremetech.com or call 267-205-4203 so you can speak with someone and get your options. And for discounted rates, be sure to tell them that War Room Sports sent you. And make sure you also check out the new War Room Sports mobile app because Digital Extreme Technologies is responsible for that as well.
My birthday, yay!
All right, in the world of baseball, Justin Upton turns 29. Shout out to him. Marvin Harrison, we just talked about him a few times in the last couple of weeks because he just was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Marv turns 44. PSP, shout out to Marv. Robert Horry, one of the most decorated team athletes. Decorated team athletes that we've ever seen. 7 championships, probably earned about two and a half of them joints. He's 46. Albert Bell, back to the world of MLB. He turns 50 today. Shout out to Albert Bell. Cornelius Bennett. Y'all remember the linebacker Cornelius Bennett? He turns 51 years old. Raleigh Fingers. Raleigh Fingers is 70 years old.
No doubt.
We want to give a couple of RIP birthday shout outs. Diego Corrales, the former boxer who died in that automobile accident. I believe he was on a motorcycle at the time. He was born August 25th, 1977. Passed away May 7th, 2007, so he would have been 39 years old. That's messed up. RIP to Althea Gibson. She broke color barriers in the world of tennis and LPGA. And she was the first tennis player to win a female tennis player of color to win a Grand Slam. She was born August 25th. 1927. She died September 28th, 2003. She'd like to give a nice big War Room salute to all of these folks on their birthdays.
Yay!
I'm going to let you guys know how you get in touch with us real quick, and then we're going to talk to Fred Perdue about what's going on in college football right after that. Y'all can check out the website, warroomsports.com. While you're there, make sure you take your time, look around, click on the Contact Us tab, send us a message about the company, the show, to inquire about sponsorship and advertising opportunities because the rates are great and they are negotiable. So holler at us if you need, you know, some promotion for your business. Or you could just join our network in any capacity. Hey, Fred might need some help. He does a lot of stuff with the college football. If you're a college football head, hit us up. You know, if you pass the test, you might be able to help out. For general inquiries, just email us, info@warroomsports.com. When you're browsing the site, click the memorabilia tab, buy something, click the blog tab, read something. Then you can click the respective icons and tabs to like all of our social media pages. We're on everything, Christian Mingle included. You can subscribe to the iTunes podcast, watch the webcast at War Room Sports TV, listen to the podcast network. You can download the free War Room Sports mobile app that I just talked about to get everything I just mentioned on the go. Join the JW Philly Realty chat room right now during the show. blogtalkradio.com/thewarroom to get in the chat room. All you got to do, if you don't already have one, sign up for a free profile on Blog Talk Radio. If you don't feel like doing all that, just sign into your Facebook and Twitter accounts. While you're at it, click follow. That'll get you any updates that you might need about the show every week. I mean, we're pretty consistent. We do this at the same time every week, so it's not many updates that you're going to need, but just in case. We'll be taking questions and reading posts from Facebook, Twitter, and the chat room during the show. If you want to call in and speak with us, the Digital Extreme Tech Hotline will be open in about 7 minutes right after Fred Perdue. That number is 323-410-0012. Press 1 when prompted. If you're already listening from your phone, just press 1 if you want to talk. So Fred Perdue and his college football report is brought to you guys in our Hot Topics segment. Jimmy, you want to let everybody know who Hot Topics are brought to him by?
Absolutely, man. And for those who don't know, who've been living under a rock, Hot Topics are brought to you by Audible. If your schedule is too hectic to read as much as you want, here's what you do. Go to audibletrial.com/.
You change your schedule.
Try out Audible. Try out Audible. Listen, man, because you can stay abreast of all the greatest books. There's a lot of good stuff out there. I'm still listening to the Muhammad Ali autobiography, and it's the most amazing thing I think I've ever read. I'm lying, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but it still is amazing because as much as I thought I knew about Muhammad Ali, I didn't know. And, you know, he's already the god in my eyes, but now it's like he's even more the god. And this book was written years ago, but it popped up on Audible, so I got the Audible book because I didn't feel like reading the regular book. So that's what you do, audibletrial.com/warroomsports. And I'm recommending right now, what I'm recommending is the Muhammad Ali book called The Greatest. It's amazing.
The Greatest.
And thank you, Audible, for your support of our podcast.
That's funny because my son is reading, you know, like a kid's version of a little Muhammad Ali novel. I'm not even sure how many pages it is, but it's like the first book that he, like, he reads books, but this is like the first, you know, biography. Like, you know, yeah. This is the kind of book that's going to take more than one day to read. Put it like that. You read some pages here, drop it, read some pages later.
Is he going to finish his book when he gets the ESPN joint or no?
Nah, I probably will never finish that. Yo, I told you, man, because it's a flight book, and then recently on flights, I didn't even feel like reading nothing. So it don't even get play on the flights no more. All right, so let's talk some college football. We got the homie Fred Perdue, the hardest working man in college football on the line. Fred, what is going on, my brother?
What's going on, fellas? How y'all doing?
Ah, man, we
Fred.
Good. We're breathing. The air is going in and out the lungs, so we cannot complain. Look, man, college football is inching closer. I know you're excited, so let's jump right into this. The NCAA is coming for Ole Miss. Tell everybody why and tell everybody what might happen.
SEC fans alike, you may want to watch out as well because Ole Miss isn't the only one to, you know, be under a little fire. But we are talking Ole Miss, and we know all
hold
of the
hold
things.
On, hold on, hold on. Let me interpret that for Fred. That means Ole Miss is about to start snitching. They about to start giving the rest of the SEC up.
Oh, no. Ole Miss doesn't have to snitch. The players that have been recruited in the past by Ole Miss, because they are going to be given immunity from all of this, will be snitching.
Ooh.
Anonymous sources will be snitching, but yeah. So we all remember what happened with Laramie Tunsil at the draft, the marijuana and the illegal recruiting. Well, this extends way back to that same class. You had himself – You also had Laquon Treadwell, and you had Robert Kendiche, three of the top players, probably top 50 players in that class, that recruiting class. Well, Ole Miss's recruiting hadn't been that great, and Ole Miss hasn't been that great dating back to Houston Nutt. That team, that school, they hadn't been great at it, and things weren't looking great. And then all of a sudden, maybe I'm not speculating. I'm not trying to put anything out there. Maybe some thousand. I mean, I don't know. I'm not trying to snitch on nobody, but you know, handshakes were given out, and you know, players ended up signing at Ole Miss.
Money
and,
handshakes.
Yeah, yeah. You know, when Robert Kendiche was supposed to go to Alabama, and he decided to go elsewhere, and you know, he ended up at Ole Miss, and Laramie Tunsil ended up at Ole Miss after they haven't had a huge big time offensive lineman signing since Michael Orr, aka Mr. Blindside, and well, Laquon Treadwell is the best receiver they've had in a long time as well. So with all of that being said, legal recruiting, 28 violations later over 13 different sports, and we all know football is the major sport here. Hugh Freeze has a lot to deal with, and it doesn't help when your prized player who should have been the number one overall pick is caught on draft night after having his Instagram hacked, and I say that with air quotes, hacked the night of the draft. None of that helps. Well, now the NCAA, they don't necessarily have subpoena power, so they're going around to different schools in the SEC to players that were formerly recruited by Ole Miss and saying, if you tell us a little bit of information about what happened during your recruiting, we'll give you immunity. And, you know, this isn't good for Ole Miss. They are in a lot of trouble. I saw this coming a mile away 3 years ago. It's just, you don't see middle of the road to very bottom tier teams come out of nowhere and have stud recruiting classes year in and year out. And I understand you may have that one great player, but you don't get three in one class. You don't get three 5-star freshmen who all turn out to be high round draft picks 3 years later without something going on.
Wow. Ole Miss,
that's your way.
And dry snitching is allowed at this point, so I'm just.
Ooh.
All right, so I know you also
wanted
to. Are they
facing the death penalty?
No, they're not going to be faced. There won't be any more real death penalties. Honestly, with them being in the SEC and being one of the budding teams in the SEC, especially the SEC West, which is the toughest division in college football, I dare anyone to put that division up against any full conference in college football, and I'd take the SEC West first. But with them being there, producing them out of funds economically, I don't think that'll happen because we all know that's where it really starts. I think they'll get a nice slap on the wrist, enough just to make them – regret what they did, but not enough to really cripple the program.
Fred, real quick, Skyview in the chat room said you should recuse yourself from commenting on recruiting violations since you represent the U.
Good one.
All right, but I know you wanted to preview Kyle versus Hawaii.
That's trying to fake Freddie you're talking about, man.
Hey, man, that was a chapter in my life that I'm trying to forget. I'm trying to forget that part of my life. I made a bad – I made a good choice.
SSF.
No, Jimmy ain't gonna never let you forget that. Matter of fact,
more people
going to know about
it
in the coming months.
We don't believe you. You need more people.
Hashtag SSF. Florida State Freddy. Let's go.
Anybody that knows me when I was on campus there, they knew I had my Miami gear on. I was not going up there with
the
Miami gear.
I was up there trying to get jumped.
Quick story, man. My first day on campus, they give out complimentary T-shirts. I got two. Because I was the resident Miami Hurricane fan coming onto campus, they asked, was I going to switch schools and make the right choice? Well, let's just say as I walked out of the building, that shirt ended up in somebody's garbage can. Sorry for what I said. I'm sorry, but I can't. I could never commit treason like that.
And then they chased you home?
No, I actually threw up the U. I took a nice picture throwing up the U right in front of the home building.
you was drunk.
Yeah,
and in front of Dope Campbell Stadium. So I'm just, you know.
Damn, you soft.
I was about to say, try that at like Temple. They'd have beat the. All right, look. Cal versus Hawaii. What's up?
Man, this game is. We know we don't have big name schools here. And I know most fans are like, Cal, Hawaii, who cares? Well, there's a quarterback you want to know about. He's going to be a quarterback that you'll need to know for the 2017 draft. That's fine. He's the highlight player of it all. Texas Tech former transfer. Davis Webb, he's come over to Cal replacing Jared Goff. He is the only reason I am watching this. Also, this is in Australia. It's down under. College football is going abroad now. We've had some rain and some flooding there, so
they
there may be some issues.
Oh, it's going abroad. My bad. Go ahead.
This game is going to be one of those games where you know who's going to win. But some of the interesting things that are going around this game, Marshawn Lynch, former Cal Bear, former Super Bowl champion, NFL player, Seattle Seahawk. We all remember Marshawn Lynch. We called him Beast Mode. Well, he actually took some snaps in practice.
Now we call him Practice Team Mode.
Yes, we call him Practice Team Mode. He's mentoring players. He's taking it all in his he couldn't stay away from the game, man. He could not. Taking snaps at a college game. I would love to see that linebacker that's wanting to tackle him.
How is this legal though? How can he suit up and be on the practice team? Like, how can he do that?
I'm still trying to figure this one out because there has to be some kind of injury waiver here. Maybe it's just he's taking a hometown discount. Maybe he wants to get that last year eligibility out of the way somehow, some loophole. I don't know. But he's mentoring.
After
he's
made
giving
millions
back to his school,
in the league,
so.
Yeah.
He's trying to get his way back into the league. Somehow he's trying to – he's like, look, I got the skills still. You know, if y'all would have gave – this is what happens you don't give me the ball on the goal line. Thank you, Marshawn. I appreciate that.
If Marshawn Lynch said he was out of retirement, he would have at least 15 teams at his door right now.
15? I'd be willing to say 32.
32, yeah.
32.
For the right.
And
right
New
price.
England should be the number one. Never mind. Never mind.
Oh, God, here we go. So what's the possibility what's the possibility that Crimson Tide might be starting a freshman?
The Alabama Crimson Tide have just had a nice carousel of quarterbacks come in. They haven't had a back-to-back year starter since A.J. McCarron and Greg McElroy. Both, by the way, won national titles. Blake Sims stepped in for A.J. McCarron and took them very far, lost in a playoff game, and the inaugural playoff game, that is, semifinals. And then you bring in Jake Coker. Jake Coker takes them to a national title after sitting a year behind Blake Sims. So now you get to try. You have a guy in Blake Barnett, a junior. You have David Cornwell from Oklahoma. He's come in as a freshman, not really doing much. I thought he would be the guy at some point. He's a big, strong, tall quarterback with a strong arm, very mobile for his size. I thought he may have a chance. But when it's all said and done, you have the young Texan, Jalen Hurts. He looks exactly like in helmets, pads. It just looks just like having Derrick Henry back there throwing the football. He's a young running quarterback who's learning the passing game. And if you bring him along slowly but surely with the running game they have behind Damian Harris and Bo Scarborough, you also give him weapons like Calvin Ridley, O.J. Howard, you know, the one that didn't kill anybody, the O.J. that didn't kill anybody, but, you know, as Alabama says. But, you know, if you bring those, if you bring him along slowly in this offense, they run the ball, they play really good defense anyway. Alabama's moving to more of a spread-type offense, but they're keeping those pro concepts there. I think this is something that Nick Saban may really consider, especially after seeing what Deshaun Watson did to him last year. seeing what these running dual threat quarterbacks are doing, you see a lot more of the power run game anyway. That just gives them another element on offense. And I think Calvin Ridley and Artavis Stewart and all the rest of those guys are going to help him out. So if they do happen to start a freshman, which would be the first time in Nick Saban's history at Alabama starting a freshman at quarterback, it would be something to take him over for the next at least 3 years. And if possibly four, that would be very dangerous because Nick Saban has never had a quarterback start longer than 2 years.
All right, well, shout out to OJ, man. If you ain't killing, you ain't trying.
R.I.P. Clemson. Just saying.
Look, before Frey get out of here, man, you guys have – first of all, you have to follow him on Twitter at FPurdue Sports. You have to go to warroomsports.com and check out all the content that he and his partners are churning out on War Room Sports. You got the previews, the conference previews. You got Quick Slants, the blog, three times a week. You got Quick Slants, the mini podcast that'll come at you two or three times a week. Look, he's doing all the work for you. Just go to warroomsports.com and partake. Get the information any way you want. If you want the information on video, it's there. If you want it on audio, it's there. If you want to read, I know a lot of y'all don't read anymore, but it's still there. And we also have the college football pick'em, and Fred will personally give anybody who can beat – well, you not only have to beat him, you have to come in first place, but if you beat him and you win the college football pick'em group, he'll personally give you $25 and a shout-out on every show that I just named for you guys. So it's worth the bragging rights. It's worth the $25. Go out and buy your lady a hamburger or something. come on, we got to get that because I know you guys like to wait till the last minute. You know, you do this in our NFL pick'em as well. Like, it'll be four people in the group, and then 10 minutes before the season starts, it's like 50 people in the group. So come on, let's get in.
Don't
this group.
Don't be scared, folks.
Let's
Don't
go
be
to.
Scared. I know
Twitter.
That win percentage scares you, but
yeah,
you know.
Let's go to Twitter. Let's follow FPurdue Sports because he has a wealth of college football knowledge to give out. Fred, you know we appreciate your time and we appreciate everything you're doing over here at War Room Sports.
Amen.
And we will see you next week, brother.
All right, guys. Thanks for having me on.
All right, no doubt.
Definitely.
That's Fred Purdue, everybody. Check him out on Twitter at FPurdue Sports. All right. Look, hot topics are in full effect. Let's put one last bow around the games of the 31st Olympiad. Rio, it was shaky going in. The games went off. I'm not going to say without a hitch because I did see people diving in the green water and they had to shut the pool down for a couple of days. I did see people in the rowing contest making sure they kept their mouth closed the whole time. So, you know, some things happen. I don't know how many people have spread Zika around the world coming off of these flights, but, you know, that's probably about to be an epidemic. But anyway, you know, the game still went. You know, the gold medals, the silver medals, the bronze medals were all still handed out. I don't think anything got canceled, so I guess that's a good job by Rio, considering all things. So, fellas, real quick, just give me a couple of your favorite moments from Rio, like either your favorite moments, favorite storylines, you know. What did it
mean? I have an unconventional one, but it's what I remember the most about this entire year. Because, you know, you have moments that, you know, are fleeting, but some things you remember forever. Mine is when Al Roker checked the ball about Ryan Lochte. He kept calling him Lochte.
When he's trying to say boys will be boys.
Yeah, when Al Roker.
Al Roker, like a grown ass man.
Yeah, because I'm not familiar with Al Roker, like, you know, that part of Al Roker, but I saw it come out. I'm like, oh, let's go, Al. You know what I'm saying? So I think I'll always remember that because, like, I remember Al Roker as the jolly weatherman, but he, like, you know, he got in his bag
jolly.
Real quick.
He called him Jolly, though. The jolly
yeah,
boy with all the gastro work.
Shout out to Al Roker, man. You get love in the war room, yo.
Yo,
nah, no doubt.
Al had a couple
of
drinks in him.
I had a few that are obvious, you know. Y'all know I've always been a big Michael Phelps fan. Like, I just think it's amazing when people dominate the way they do. So, of course, Michael Phelps going out the way he did after we thought London was his last games. Of course, Usain Bolt doing what he did. You know, another 3 for 3 on his part. One of the more sentimental moments for me was when Simone Manuel won the freestyle, because even though she had to share the gold with somebody, this comes down to like the emotional part of the game, like her reaction when she realized, because I think at some point when you're not even the favorite, you just put your head down and you just go as fast as you can. You touch the wall and then you look up to see what's up. Like in Katie Ledecky's races, like she didn't have to have that reaction because she was like the only person in the frame on some of her races. So she knew when she touched the wall what it was hitting for. But this one was so dramatic because there was no way she was even supposed to win. She wins the joint. After she touches, she looks back, sees the screen. I think she was just hype at first because she medaled. Like you see the top three, and then she saw gold next to her name. And the reaction she had and how important that was, even though a lot of people out there tried to dismiss the importance of it, tried to, how they do when we get happy about something. They try to, now we're all Americans.
We're all
when we're just being black every day of the week, you know what I'm saying? The black community does this and they do this. But then when a black person does something that we're proud of, I don't see what the big deal is. You're all Americans. Why does it have to be a black swimmer? Well, it's been explained several times on social media because there were situations like the Dorothy Dandridge situation where they threatened to drain a whole pool just if she stuck her toe in it. So to come from that, then to get on the world stage and win an individual gold medal when you weren't even supposed to, it's a big deal. We still make
it
big deals in 2016. Live with it. So that one, and I have one more that's really unconventional. Nobody probably even knows about this one because this is one of them things you up watching late night. Not even an all-around, not even a team joint, but I was watching the men's final for floor exercise, and they had two Brazilian dudes in it who, just like Simone Manuel, had no chance of meddling. Brazil, I think they only won like one gold medal the whole damn game. They were the host country. These dudes, there was two Brazilians in the final, and they actually won silver and bronze. But the emotion these dudes showed when they realized that they were going to win, and then when it was over and they could just finally let it out, and, the crowd was behind them. Yo, that was one of the craziest moments for me of the whole game. And probably like six people saw it. Because it's what it's all about sometimes, man. When you watch, like, people, their hard work paid off in a surprising manner, and these dudes just let it all out, yo. I mean, the gymnast's a little soft anyway, but. So those were
Man.
I thought it was all Olympic.
I just want to say a couple comments on what Dev said. First off, Katie Ledecky, I want to remember that, too, because she threw your body bag, everybody, even us watching. That's like, that was ridiculous.
She body bagged the world record too.
I don't think I've ever seen anybody get body bagged like that. She was done. She did her taxes, made a sandwich, babysat. And they still weren't done. It was ridiculous.
How did she win that far ahead of every other field? That was crazy.
I don't even know. That's the one thing. Second thing I want to say is I'm not
a crazy distance swimmer.
I'm not speaking specifically about Dorothy Dandridge, but some of y'all do need to wash y'all feet, man. I'm gonna keep that short to myself.
Jim, and I'm gonna get in trouble for this one though. Not really. Why do people feet be the ones that be dirty though, y'all? I ain't gonna front. Like, I always see a lot of like white chicks. And they take their shoe off or something, and their feet be dirty.
Pink feet.
So it's like, y'all want to drain pools for us, man. Wash your feet. That's all.
That's all I'm saying, man. Some of y'all need to wash your feet, man. Wash it. Anyway, my favorite.
Man. First and foremost, y'all know me.
So before we get down to the specifics,
like, y'all know me. I would like to
send a shout out to the whole continent of Africa, because without Africa, the Olympics as it's currently constituted would not be possible. Yo, shout out to slavery in America, slavery in Brazil, and the European empires that put slavery and colonization on the map, man. Because of y'all, the Olympics are possible, and you can look at these weird nations like, damn.
The echo chamber.
I didn't know there was black people in Scandinavia. I didn't know there was black people here. I didn't know there was black. Yo, shout out to y'all. Yo, Usain Bolt, don't quit.
Yo, did you see the black dude who ran anchor in the 4x1 for Japan?
And he ain't had nothing to do with slavery.
And they meddled.
He had nothing to do with slavery.
He was awful.
He did all the work. He did all the work, too. But, yo, shout out to Usain, man. Don't quit, man. Come back just one more time for the people, man. Just set that record, that bar out of reach, because by the way he looked, he's got another two Olympics in him at least.
Yeah, see, but that's easy to say, but, you know, the Olympics 4 years apart, though. He looked like that today.
Yeah, that's,
next year, he might fall.
Yo,
my man is known
to party pretty heavy when it's all. Yo, shout out to Black Girls Rock.
They caught him. He in the news recently.
Hashtag, Yeah, of course. Shout out to
he was in bed with somebody.
Black Girl Magic. I was really impressed with the U.S. teams, the U.S. women's track team, particularly the hurdlers, Brianna Rollins, Mia Ali, and Christy Castlin. They swept the 100-meter hurdles. Salute to them doing their thing. Salute to Simone Emanuel, and salute to my man Carmelo Anthony for going to the hood, going to the favela, and hanging out in the hood with the Brazilians. Nobody really covered that. They didn't really feature that. Why would they? But, salute to him. So those were my moments in the Olympics. Simone Emanuel for bringing the light to police brutality in the U.S.
Just Manuel, man, not Emanuel.
Yo, man.
Yeah,
salute,
change their name.
Salute to all the Brazilian women over there of a certain profession who took care of all the athletes while they were visiting, man. Salute to y'all,
salute,
man.
Salute to all the hustling young boys who robbed somebody and came up during the Olympics. Do your thing, you know what I'm saying? Come to your town.
You know what I'm saying?
Take their wallets, rip their green cards. But the medal count, the top five medal-winning countries, the United States with 121 total medals, 46 gold, Great Britain, 67 total, 27 gold, China, 70 total, 26 gold, Russia, 56 total, 19 gold. They won a lot to have a lot of people that couldn't even participate. Germany, 42 medals total, 17 gold. So shout-out to Rio, doing your thing. Where is it in 4 years? They're going back to Asia somewhere, right? Anybody?
I don't even know where it is. I think it's in South Philly.
Don't ask me, but if they're going to have it in Asia, salute to Bangkok Phuket.
No, it's in Tokyo. It's in Tokyo.
Oh, it's in Tokyo.
Yeah. So, shout out to Tokyo. Don't think I'm going there. Don't think I'm interested. All right, so one thing about Bolt, remember we read something. This is not the first time he said that, though. But Usain Bolt, with even more popularity now, he said that if you want to shoot an ad for him, if any endorsers want to shoot an ad for him, it has to be done in Jamaica because he's trying to bring money to his country and create jobs for his countrymen. So shout out to Bolt for looking out for his. A lot of people don't look out for theirs.
Man, way to look out for the cookout.
Shout out to Speedo, Ralph Lauren, Gentle Hair Removal, and Airweave, which is a mattress company. These were all four of the companies that endorsed Ryan Lochte. They have all dropped him for his – I still do not get what this lie in this story was about and what it was going to get him in the benefits category. Now it's totally gotten him, you know, dropped from his endorsers, probably blackballed from the competition. He wanted to come back for another Olympics.
Lost.
Because he realized, you know, Phelps wasn't going to be there, so he's going to give it one more shot. And there's no way that Ryan Lochte is going to be on the Olympic team at 36 years old, for one. But secondly, just being the dude who went over there and embarrassed the U.S. delegation. And fellas, I don't understand what this story was made up for. Like,
I don't understand what he was ducking by
making this up. Or was he just trying to be, like, the hero dude? I don't get it. I don't get it. I still don't get it.
I mean, maybe I watched too much Law & Order SVU, but I think maybe he was fornicating with a young Brazilian boy. And, you know,
this is a way to get around that story.
I mean, maybe I watched too many dramas on TV, but
yes, you
that's the
about.
Only thing I could think of.
So he was just trying to deflect and deflected his way into infamy.
When he really was out there in them streets going at night.
Yo, you silly, man. All right, and also Hope Solo, the goalie for the U.S. women's soccer team, they just kind of voided her contract, and she's been suspended for 6 months. For basically, they're saying it's because of all the stuff she's done. They say it's just like an add-up of everything she's been, quote-unquote, in trouble for. But the latest thing she's done and what they reacted to was her calling the Swedish team cowardly. Now, she said this because, you know, in the game that they lost, it kind of makes her look a little like a sore loser. But if you saw that game or if you read about it, if you, you know, watched any of it, the way they played, I think a lot of people would agree. But, you know, athletes aren't allowed to speak their mind, especially when it's something that most people think is, quote-unquote, unsportsmanlike. But the Swedes kind of deployed this all-defensive strategy. They deployed this all-defensive strategy when they played the United States women, to the point where they won the game and they only took 2 shots on goal. The Americans took 25 shots on goal because they, you know, they weren't about that offensive life. They were just going to sit back and play a defensive game. I've heard other people say, and I'm not really in the know in soccer, I've heard a lot of people say that strategy is kind of cowardly. I guess it's like four corners in basketball, mm-hmm. like with a 10-point lead in the middle of the third quarter. Like,
it is. It's the exact same thing. It's there's an offense called possession. And possession
is it like three straight quarters of Hackershack? Would that be equivalent?
Three straight quarters of Hackershack, they don't cross the ball over the line to actually go try and score a goal. They just deploy 11 players on the defensive half and play keep away. And it's like, it's a form of possession, which possession is another type of offense, which is beautiful when it's deployed right, but it's not meant to just not take shots. Like, 2 shots on goal, that's cowardly. If you're only going to shoot the ball twice, you're a coward.
Yeah.
I agree with Hope.
Yo, I mean, if soccer, like, cause, you know, I've never played, but if it's anything like basketball, you know me. I'm 2 shots for me is just not even acceptable.
Yo,
so.
Soccer is basketball. What's your team?
So if I'm taking like a dub in a basketball game, I'm taking at least 5 shots on goal in the soccer game. So 2 for the whole team. Yeah, it sounds a little cowardly to me. But you know, you can't really speak. And it's not just that athletes can't speak their mind, because some can. What I've heard, and especially from female journalists, that this is just another example of the sexism that goes on in sports. They said, you know, the sexist nature of sports. I heard somebody liken it to, okay, if she calls somebody cowardly for doing something that is pretty cowardly, she gets a 6-month suspension and she gets all of this backlash. But you have, like, you know, Michael Phelps saying some things about his opponent and all that kind of stuff, and everybody's like praising him, like, yeah, you know. Lily King
true.
Got a little backlash for the things that she said about the Russian chick as well.
Mm.
So
in a vacuum, that's true. But because of Hope Solo's reputation and her past,
yeah, she don't get the benefit of the
created,
doubt.
She don't get the benefit of the doubt.
Right.
That's
so
that conversation.
Yeah.
It becomes a challenge because of her reputation.
Right. Because Hope Solo be like beating up sisters and nephews, and you know, she got a domestic abuse charge, and she was the aggressor.
Aggressive abuse.
Hope Solo
was
that.
She was beating up a coward. Come on, man, move on.
Yeah, I mean, she doesn't get the benefit of the doubt for a lot of reasons. I mean, for one, the way she abuses her family. I mean, for two, when you saw the pictures of her taco leaking, it looked like the Baltimore Harbor Tunnel. She should have been suspended right there.
You somehow all the towel be missing in that. Sorry.
Yo, she should have got 2 years for that. Like, what were you doing? Anyway, yo, but Dev, real quick though, no disrespect to Hope Solo, but I was thinking about something you said. You said one of the companies that dumped Ryan Lochte was a mattress company called General Hair Removal and Air Reed.
But no, the General Hair Removal was something else. The mattress company is called.
Oh,
Air
man,
Reed.
I was thinking like. Yeah!
Yo, Jimmy been thinking about that for like 5 minutes. Like, what?
Because I'm listening to you read the companies. I'm like, why is a hair weave company making mattresses? Like, what part of the game is that?
No, it's called Air Weave. And now it's on General Hair Removal. Yeah, he got dropped by everybody, so he's a noodle. Taking it to the NBA real quick. What did you guys think about the interviews with John Wall and Bradley Beal, where they basically admitted that they kind of dislike each other on the court? I don't think they were saying that this spans outside of it, but I don't. It's weird for me to hear them say that, though, because it sounds to me like they're trying to say we don't really like playing together. I don't like his style. He doesn't like my style. But Bradley Beal just read up with them for like a max contract. If you didn't like playing with this boy, he the best player on the team. He not going nowhere. So
yeah,
obviously it's something that they're just going to have to work on and get it right. Or was this not as serious as everybody's making it? What are y'all thoughts on this one?
I don't think it was serious, but at the same time, I agree. There's a couple layers to this. There's John Wall's not going anywhere. Because he is, like it or not, a top 5 point guard in the NBA. So he's not going anywhere. And then you got Bradley Beal, who just signed that huge deal, even though he's going to be on minute restrictions for the rest of his life. I don't understand it, the chemistry. If you watch them play, you can kind of see it a little bit. You can kind of. There's something mechanical about their backcourt. I've seen them play well together. I've seen them stink it up, but I've never seen it move seamlessly. I don't know. There's something a little off about this. So I'd be surprised if either one of them play on the same contract.
My question to you guys is, like, why are they trying to make this like a Kobe Shaq thing now? Because I know he's a good player, but I think Bradley Beal gets a little too much credit on the, you know, on what he is and what his game is. I think Bradley Beal is good, but I don't think Brad Beal is a superstar. I don't think he's a max player.
No, he's not. That's only here.
Yo, Kobe,
because we're here in D.C. Yeah, that's only
right,
here because
right.
we're in D.C.,
exactly,
and that's only because of the contract. That's only because
of
the contract.
Hold on, real quick. The issue isn't what they said. Because I don't know how true it is, and I don't know exactly what they were trying to express, but my issue is them not thinking and actually saying this, because regardless of whatever it is they meant, this could be taken as a distraction. It could take away from whatever they're trying to build over there. So my biggest issue is the fact that you two jabronis felt comfortable talking like this. Where's your coach at? Like, you gotta, like, that's my biggest issue with it, is the fact that they felt it was okay to talk like this. Like, that can't help the team.
And it sounds like I can read the comments from John Wall that I think started all of this. It kind of sounds like he's talking down on the dude, but the way I see it, this is the hierarchy of things. Like, I really think Brad Beal gets a lot of credit from a lot of people, and you know, I watch a lot of Wizards game. I live in that market, so I don't really understand what people see. I mean, the boy, he can shoot. Is that? I don't see a lot with Bradley Beal in terms of being able to create his own shot. Maybe that's some of the beef. Maybe John Wall never gives him the ball to create his own shot. I don't know, but I don't see that in his game. Then you have the thing that B. Austin mentioned. Like, how do you get paid like that if you're on a minutes restriction for the rest of your career? Like, I just don't get the excitement around Bradley Beal. I think he's a very good player, but, like, the excitement is kind of like, oh, man, we got this. Remember, they were putting them in, like, the best backcourt in the league conversation. And some people, before last season started, were saying they were the best backcourt in the league.
I don't think I hear a lot of that outside of D.C. I'll ask Jimmy. Jimmy, do you hear that type of chatter outside of D.C. about Bradley Beal?
Maybe it's because
no,
I live
actually,
here.
Well, here's the thing. Hold on. Here's the thing. To Dev's point, I heard it before the start of last season. By the time the end of the season got around, I no longer heard it. But coming into
both.
The season, no, coming into the season, and I'm not mistaken, we may have had a verse that people were talking about, you know, Beal. And Bill and Wall versus, like, you know, Steph and Clay, like,
Steph,
literally,
yeah.
That was literally a debate between who had the better.
Yeah,
backup.
I remember that.
Now,
but the thing
yeah,
is,
so once, but towards the end of the right. season, you ain't hear that no more. Like, people got quiet with that.
See, and the funny thing is, bringing up Clay, like, and people would think, like, after I said what I just said, and then I'm gonna say what I'm about to say, they're gonna be like, well, how you gonna, you know, sound like you're giving him a compliment? But he reminds me. He's in the mold to me of a Klay Thompson. So people will probably think, like, well, you just said all that about him, and then you're going to compare him to Klay. That's because I don't think Klay is as good as his reputation is. But
yeah,
if you compare the two, I think both of them have limited. But listen, I think they have limited games as two guards as far as, you know, creating and doing anything besides their strong suit of shooting. But at the same time, there's not many times you're going to see Bradley Beal get hot and just roast the defense like Klay Thompson. When Klay Thompson, he has those moments, those quarters where he gets zoned in, and it don't matter what you're doing out there, he's going to pull up and he's going to make the shot. He's not going to, like, you know, get you out there in a one-on-one and put you in the popcorn machine and then dunk on you. That's not the type of dude he is, but he can get hot on you. But I think they both have the same limitations. Maybe this is the new, era of superstar shooting guards. Maybe this is what they do. Maybe we're not going to see, at least on this go around in this cycle, maybe we're not going to see the Kobe Bryants or the Dwayne Wades, those type of dudes. Maybe Klay Thompson and Bradley Beal are the prototype for this particular era of shooting guards.
Well,
and if it becomes to be that way,
then
I can take some of this back.
That's a good point.
I think it's something, too, that considering the point guard position has changed, this is kind of what they do. Like, they become these guys that play off the point guard. Yeah, they play off the
point guard. Because the point guards are so dominant and doing so much creation and within the offenses, you don't need an uber-creative two guard. The only two guard I'm thinking of that really stands out other than Dwayne Wade as super creative would be James Harden. So James Harden is still creative, but outside of him, I can't think of two guards that are really, like, handle the ball and come down, pick and roll. You know, Klay kind of stands off, and, you know, he might create for himself. He certainly isn't creating for anybody else.
No. Shout out to James Harden for his new sneaker that look like love. But it's funny because when we talk about this, when we talk about the game of basketball, it's like a living thing, the way it changes based upon, like, a lot of different variables that go into making basketball change. But it's literally like a living thing when you see how, because the point guard plays this way, then the two guard changes, and it goes down from level to level. We talk about college and high school, like, two guards change the way they play the game.
Right.
Yo, is Victor Oladipo a two guard or a one or a combo? I know he's a combo, but is he more two guard or more one?
I would say more shooting guard. But
yeah, he plays the two more.
But listen, these are John Wall's comments, and these don't get a little, like, if I'm Bradley Beal and I hear this, I would think, not on this first part, but on the second one, I'll let you know when it gets into the realm where I would think he's, like, talking down on me a little bit. But he starts off by saying, I think a lot of times we have a tendency to dislike each other on the court. We got to be able to put that to the side. If you miss somebody on one play or don't have something go right, as long as you come to each other and talk. If I start arguing with somebody, I'm cool. I'm just playing basketball. Then this is the part where I would be, like, kind of raising my eyebrows if I'm Bradley Beal. He said, because he brought up his money, he said, now that you have your money, you got to go out there and improve your game. I want you to be an all-star just as much as I'm an all-star. If we were playing well as a tandem, like the other two superstars that play together as a backcourt play as a tandem, one night is going to be this night, one night is going to be mine, some nights are going to be both of us. Those are nights that are going to be tough to beat us. So it sounds like he, like, young boy, get, you know, you got your money now, to get your game up. Like, you done bitch, you got your money.
You got to keep that in-house. You got to keep that thing in-house, as Jimmy said. But I get exactly what he's saying because, Devin, we've been in D.C. and we watch, dude. What's changed about Bradley Beal's game since he's coming in? He's still the same player.
The fact that he played less than handle.
To me, when Dev reads that statement, I look at that the same way I look at a dog marking their territory.
Like, yeah, exactly. Yo, Jim, yeah, you got to put – you got to – it's something to what you just said, because it might be something like, all right, what he really wanted to say is, okay, now that you make more money than me, now you got to go out there. That's how I read it. That's how it sounded
like,
to me. Now that you make more money than me.
I don't know if there's any other way to read it.
He's like, now that you make just as much or more than me.
That was a lion saying, yo, it's still my stuff. Like,
right,
I mean, you over here with us now, but this is still all me.
Yo.
He basically said,
you're
making
itself
as much as me now or more than me, and I'm still better.
Now,
and I'm going to be
Now watch. As y'all say, John Wall gets 19 and 10. So John Wall is responsible for what? Essentially about 40 points a game. Bradley Beal cannot score more than 20 a game if he can score 20. And he's not going to get you more than 3 assists. So he's never going to be equal in John Wall in terms of value. Because John is getting, is creating, or instrumental on 40 points a game. Yo, I think they made a mistake in signing that contract. That was interesting. And John Wall plays defense, but we don't got to get into defense.
You said Bill made a mistake signing a contract?
No.
The Wizards.
Oh, I'm about to
the Wizards made a mistake.
Bill made no mistake.
Bill was flawless. Bill was flawless in stealing that money. Bill went in there with the mask.
Bill got a nice ransom.
Yeah. He was brilliant. Brilliant Bradley Beal. That's a new nickname.
He was brilliant.
Brilliant
Bradley
Beal.
Man.
Sound like a boxer. Brilliant Bradley Beal. Tongue
shout
twister.
To brilliant
Ocean's,
Bradley Beal.
Ocean's 11. He hit him with the Ocean's 11.
All right.
Uh-huh.
I know – We always running into our football segment, but I know you guys wanted to spit a couple bars on this. This is more of an entertainment story, but hey, Nate Parker used to be a wrestler. So Nate Parker, for you guys didn't know, who don't know, you know, he's the director and the actor behind the Nat Turner movie that's coming out, Birth of a Nation. By all accounts and all the awards that it's won at the film festivals, like this is set to be his crowning achievement, his crowning glory. You know, it's just supposed to be big. Really good movie, really well done, story nicely told. Well, he has a 16-year-old rape case, which he was acquitted for 16 years ago, that somehow, with the great timing of oppression, it's crept its way back into the forefront right before his crowning achievement was to be unveiled upon the world. And you actually have now, you know, Jimmy and I, you guys know we do an Oscar show. You know, we every year before the Oscars, we make our picks. They have Oscar viewers and, you know, Oscar judges or whatever who are basically saying that they're probably not going to see his movie because critics are basically calling him a rapist. You guys got thoughts on this and the
timing
of
this?
First off, white people won.
I'm gonna give my pick now
oppression
for film of the year. I'm taking this movie right here. No, I haven't seen it, and I know we do our show next year, but it's my pick already. FOH. The timing of this is very suspect. And it's like they're throwing all kinds of – it's not just this. The week before this, they put out pictures of his family because he's married to a white woman and they have four kids. So all of a sudden –
they're just trying to destroy everything about him.
Yeah, they sent those pictures to, like, you know, the tastemakers, which they call Black Twitter. So they went off on that, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Then after that couldn't bring him down, so they sent out this story. It's like it's very fishy. Like you said, he was acquitted. The story was crazy.
No. You said that couldn't bring him down. I say that was systematic in its execution. We are watching the flawless execution of a man's character. They're executing dude's cat because when they showed him with his white wife, Black Twitter went crazy and he lost black women. Then you bring about the rape case and he lost all of the black women.
All
so women. Sisters, I'm talking to people and they're like, yo, we're not messing with him. We don't care what the movie is about. So, yeah, he's done. Flawless execution. Flawless.
It's ridiculous,
yeah.
Man. Like, I could separate Nate from that for me personally. And I think Nate's getting a bad rap, but I could separate Nate from that anyway. And, you know, I saw clips of the movie. I've heard people that have seen it talk about it. And it's funny how, depending upon, it basically is breaking down amongst race lines. I've heard of white people walking out of the screenings because they're so upset. And it's sort of like one of those things, right? We know the nasty history of our country, but some people like to just act like it never happened and don't want to deal
with
it.
They don't want to see it told truthfully, Jim. They don't want
to
see it told truthfully.
Yeah, boy. It's like, but to
yeah,
me,
they
want to
see the movies
kinda,
where, you know, it's the good white man who's trying to help the slaves and, you know,
yo,
Matthew McConaughey, Jim.
That's kind of ass backwards. The greatness of our country is how far we have come, even though we still have a long ways to go. Like, you can't just ignore the bad. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
You know, it's like
how far have we come?
Man,
how far what?
I'm sorry. What? Excuse me. I was just commenting. Jimmy said we've come so far.
Oh,
I said
Chamber,
how far have we
Echo
come?
Chamber's about to attack me for saying that we've come far. Listen, I know.
I mean,
we're
not.
Ways to go,
yeah. I mean,
fact,
I'm not like
that, the fact that, the
getting
fact
whipped
that we
on a plantation. So
and have this conversation right now means we've come a long way. Back then, we couldn't have had this conversation, yo.
we couldn't even let them know that we is learning to read. what you doing
you
learning to read, nigger?
Like, we came a long way, man. I would have been
killed my son already. They'd have whipped the
all the white women getting pressure onto their body. I would have been dead.
Yo, but yeah, the timing is crazy. And what's worse, you know, all the details are, you know, coming out because, like I said, he was acquitted of this 16 years ago. Not that an acquittal makes you innocent, but he was acquitted of this. When the tide turned, when the shoe's on the other foot, that's what they try to run on us. Like, you know, it wasn't proven. He was acquitted. But, you know, if you don't like a person, then or you don't want to like what they're about, then that no longer matters. But can you guys hear me? In addition to all that, the alleged victim committed suicide in 2012. So no matter what she was going through in her life at that time, no matter what it might have been about, you know, the people who are looking at this story is going to link it all back to the alleged rape from Nate Parker and his fellow wrestler or whoever else was involved. It's going to be that way whether it was that way or not. Like, she could have gone through something else totally that caused her to take her own life. But the fact that the information is coming out the way it is, people are going to pin that on him as well. So he's really in a bad spot right now. Like I said, he has the greatest thing that he's ever done in his profession about to be unveiled on the world, and this is how they're doing the man. So it's crazy. We'll actually talk about this some more, and I'm pretty sure.
Yeah,
I just want to talk about separating Nate from Matt, because I know Woody Allen won plenty of awards after his nonsense came out. What's the other director that raped great people and he won a bunch of awards?
R. Kelly.
Kelly.
Yo, he's the director.
Oh, R. Kelly directed in the closet.
No, it's another one. What's his name? Norm? No, I can't think of his name, but I know that Woody Allen married his daughter, so.
Which he committed, like, statutory rape on.
Yeah, he statutory raped his daughter and he married her, so. But he still won Academy Award, so. But he had the right complexion for the connection, so.
Yeah.
Yo, Nate, don't worry, Nate. We're going to get you a BET Award.
I brought up R. Kelly and y'all laugh. But think about R. Kelly and what he committed and what he did. A lot of black women still listen to R. Kelly's music that won't mess with Nate Parker's music.
I mean, I don't know.
Nate Parker.
Yeah, like, I don't know, man. Like, R. Kelly's music is fire, though. I can separate R. Kelly from his from what he do in real life. That's his business, man. The music is fire, dude. But. Same way with me. Yo, I'm going to watch that movie opening night. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's stupid. All right, so before we get into some football talk, real quick, stat of the week. This is Olympics related. B. Austin already gave props to Melo for what he did outside of the games. But Carmelo Anthony is now Team USA's all-time leading scorer and rebounder. And he has the most Olympic gold medals, which is 3, of any player, any basketball player to ever, you know, compete in Olympic competition. So, Melo Anthony is Mr. Olympics for now. I see Kevin Durant probably breaking all these records at some point, but because dude is scoring at crazy clips in the Olympics, and if he decides he wants to go get 3, he probably can do that. But for now, Melo is the man. All right, real quick, before we talk a little NFL preseason to land this puppy, y'all can check out the website, warroomsports.com, if you want to call in and speak with us about any of your chosen NFL preseason topics. You can do that. The Digital Extreme Tech hotline is open. It's 323-410-0012. Press 1 when prompted. If you already listen from your phone, just press 1 if you want to talk. All right, now. Yo,
yeah.
I haven't even looked at the phone lines. We probably got people who have been holding for like, damn.
Yeah.
It's on you, big dog. What you want to do? You want to take calls or you want to start talking this football?
We can take calls. Before we take calls, let me let you know who this NFL preseason is brought to you by. That's Sports the Book. That's the greatest sports book ever written. Bottom line, you can get it at sportsthebook.com or warroomsports.com. Make sure you support. The homie Tobias has been holding the longest, man. Let's get him on the line. I know he got some bars about something. Tobias, what's up,
Hey, man, I'll tell you what, man. Boy, I tell you, I thought we were cool, man. They have been treated like a redheaded stepchild now. Man, had to charge my phone up waiting on Dale. But anyway, all right. Make this real quick.
I forgot my duties, man. I forgot my duties.
I hit these things real quick. Dak Prescott, Cowboys fans, calm down. The dude
was all right
in college football and his vanilla defense in the NFL. He's going to be a decent backup quarterback. No shame in that. Joey Bosa is going to lose more money than he would if he took the deal with the Chargers because in the draft next year, Tim Williams, Jonathan Allen, and Miles Garrett of Texas A&M are going to go higher than him anyway.
Yo,
so
Joey Bosa is bugging right now, man. I don't know who he thinks he is. He thinks he already J.J. Watt. He probably going to be Mike Mamula. He need to chill.
Yeah, and here's the thing. Y'all talk about Nate Parker, and y'all know I got something to say about this. Here's the problem. Most black people out there are sheep. Black Twitter is a joke as well because you don't own Twitter. You're up there jocking some white guy who created a Twitter site. If you're going to be black Twitter, create your own Twitter. But anyway, here's the problem. Black people get mad at white daddy.
Instead of calling it black Twitter, call it better.
Yeah. Hey, you know, all these black people, they get mad when white daddy tells them to get mad. A black man who supposedly raped a white woman in the United States was found not guilty. You got black men serving decades in prison.
So you mean the evidence has to be overwhelming if he got off on that? You know?
Yes,
it has to be.
And she admitted
he got off. Never mind.
Yeah,
and you know, that was a $17,000 settlement. Now, for sexual assault, rape, that was pretty much a legal fee the school paid out. And let's be honest here, people. He should have signed with Byron Allen. He should have gone with Byron Allen. Oh, my bad. That's another black man married to a white woman. But y'all, Precious, Will, and Jada ain't done on the black people because their production company's all white. Jay-Z's title, all white, pretty much. Your black president, black wife ain't done squat for y'all either, but you ride for them. But a man who wanted to make a movie, who took his own money, and that what white folks are really mad about because he used his own money and got some black folks in Hollywood to put their money in to create this movie without their permission.
And Nate Parker ain't got any money, so shout out to him.
Yeah, and they see, they ain't mad at that. But you got these black people, well, you know, he did. It's like, look here. How many of y'all still watch the NFL and the Pittsburgh Steelers? Ben Roethlisberger had 2 rape cases in a year. But black folks still ride for the Steelers. Black folks still ain't thinking about Roman Polanski all those years, the man raping a 12-year-old girl. And I think that man's still
That's
on the run.
His name.
That's
what
you're talking
Roman
about, Roman Polanski. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate that.
Oh, it gets better. How many of these women still bumping R. Kelly? And the stories were in Chicago. A lot of women are serving their daughters up to R. Kelly, including the one, the mother of the daughter he's dating now, 19-year-old girl.
Yo, Chocolate Factory is fire.
Oh, yo, he's dating a 19-year-old now?
Yeah,
she
right
was
now 18.
She was 18. She was 18 when the story broke, Dev, and he's been dating her for 3 years.
Go ahead. Yeah.
I can't tell the nine of numbers that you often talking, but I know she's 19 now.
I know you like
the dude learns no lessons.
Even if that's not true,
like he's still just towing that line. Why are you dealing with 19?
Yeah, he's drawn. He's definitely drawn. He should have dated someone 20 years his senior. But he liked them young yams. Listen, man, he's a terrible creep, but the music was fire. I mean, Michael Jackson was a never mind. Let me shut up.
And you know what, though? Here's the other thing that I could say this because, hey, I don't work for you guys. We got to discuss that anyway. But anyway, I want some conversation here, you know. But here's the thing. White folks know how to close ranks. They may not like you, but they close ranks. You don't hear one single white person going off throwing Big Ben Roethlisberger on the bus. But black folks will throw a man who was found innocent on the bus. That's because
we have an inferiority complex. We like to see our own fall because it makes us feel better about ourselves. We still have a lot of self-esteem issues. They definitely close ranks and protect their own better than we do. Like, you know, we have people who are talented but maybe a scumbag, and we throw them out to the wolves, and we join in with our pitchforks because it makes us feel better about ourselves. Bottom line.
And I know you got other people. And my thing is this. You can agree with a man dating a white, marrying a white woman or whatnot, if that's your thing or not. But he ain't going around saying, hey, look at my white wife. You black women ain't about nothing. He ain't done that. He just did his thing, making his money, taking care of his family.
He said like Uncle
Rick.
I mean, he's actually made statements to the contrary. When they tried to get him to play a movie and wear lipstick, Bo was like, no, I'm tired of y'all trying to emasculate the black man. So he already had Hollywood pissed out.
He ain't confused.
That reason. Yeah, so.
A lot of these black people are. I'll say this real quick. Like all these black people who, like a lot of them who are with the, you know, the Caucasians, the Anglo-Saxons, they're a lot of confused when they think they elevated themselves. Next thing you know, they out with the trash. Ask Rihanna that time, she asked Kutcher, had his fun with her, thought she was moved up. But Ashton had a good time. But I just want to say this, black people, this is the stuff right here where a man used his own money. They didn't like that. If he had made a Soul Plane 2, another integration flick, asking Mr. Charlie to help him out or something, that would have been it. Or he made a gay black man, that would have been, they would have greenlit that. They don't like unapologetically black. And one more thing, Nate Parker did not say he was a man of color. He said black. Yeah, I'm done.
All right, man.
Hey!
Roll damn tide.
Roll damn tide.
Tobias
need to go stand in the refrigerator for a minute. Cool off. You all right?
Tobias is sitting at fire.
Uh-huh. Y'all peace out, man.
All right, man. We'll talk to you next week. Tell him why you mad, son. That's what's up. All right, man. We have some of that stuff that we call breaking news. Yo, your man Ryan Lochte has reportedly been charged over his false robbery claim, and he has been summoned back to Rio. He is ruining his life over this. He thought he was cool. He's probably not going to go, but I don't know. You think
he got to feel real stupid.
You think the state's going to hand him over?
They're not going to do that.
Or they're going to let him, you know, they're going to let him get a side of Shakur on in America.
Yo,
he's just going to be chilling.
He better stay on the low from the Jake and the Taurus. That's what he better do.
Yeah, that's crazy. We got some more calls on the line. Y'all want to go ahead and take them?
Yeah.
We only got a few minutes left.
You know where I'm
going to get to these QBs.
Yo.
267.
It's Corey.
Corey, what up, dog?
Corey, what's up, Aki?
Corey Cam.
All right. We couldn't screen it. We was in a rush. What's going on, man? How you?
We good, man. I'm just listening to y'all, man. Y'all got into a lot of crazy stuff tonight, man. Y'all man got into a lot of crazy things, man. Like, I don't even know where to begin. Like,
crazy.
like the Lochte John, like, he done. Hey. Like, his life over. Like, he might be
damn.
Yo, for real. Like, when you're an Olympian, your whole money come off getting, you know what I mean, people to support you. He didn't blew that. Like, everybody didn't fell off him, and it ain't like he's 22. He's 32. He's not. He's done. He might
right.
as well.
So, basically, if he don't got to do a bid in a dirty Rio jail, then he got to at least get a job when he come back. Cause like you said, once the endorphins go, like, what else is there with swimming?
Yeah, he might as well apply at the Postal Service right now. Like, he might as well go and make that happen.
Well, that ain't going to work either. You know he ain't getting no U.S. government jobs after
he
done embarrassed them like that.
He got a charge. He can't even apply for to the government. He done.
He might as well go cop some work and put his life on.
Right?
Anyway.
He might as well move to Colorado and just start a farm and shit, grow farm and shit, do something. He done. As far as Nate Parker, like, you know, our people be tripping on one another. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know who your last caller was, but some of his points was valid. Like, we got to rock with boys regardless, you know what I mean? Because, like, for me, I'm going to tell you like this, man. I'm all black all the time. Everything I do is unapologetically black. So, like, if that man, you know what I mean, took his own money and made this film and is unapologetically black, we got to go unapologetically support it. Like, I'm going to go take me, my kids, and then I'm going to go back myself like 3 times. Like,
real talk, like, you know, now that I got Jimmy as my entertainment consultant, like, these are the only type of movies that I even pay for anymore. Like, everything else is just getting Bobby Bonilla'd. Like, but, these are the only after messing with the Blueprint, like, I ain't got to go. I used to go to the movies like twice a week. I used to support everybody. They're the only ones getting
my support. I'm definitely paying for this. I'm at the movie. I'm supporting. You know what I'm saying?
Dude,
I'm about to make a T-shirt up that says Nat is greater than Nate.
I'm gonna tell y'all something funny though, Cam. I'm not even going to the joint. I'm just gonna pay for a few tickets because if I go in and see the movie,
it's definitely gonna be
uncomfortable for anybody in the theater who's not black.
Then we gotta finish what Brother Nate started. So I'm probably not, you know what I'm saying? Nat didn't finish, you know what I'm saying? And my man Huey tried, but you know, I don't wanna inspire myself to get there. So I'm gonna just pay for tickets and let other people go see on my own. Because I know the Bulldogs.
I'm going to tell you like this. That's how I was when I was young. I had to watch Rosewood and all that stuff in the crib. I couldn't even go to the movies because I used to be hostile like that. Like, man, I might come out here and snack with somebody and break somebody's neck as I see something like that. Like, I really had to watch those at the crib. Like, I couldn't even go to the movies. Like, I rented them joints like four times because I was like, all right, I couldn't support it at the movies, so let me go ahead and rent these joints. I really was on some real hyper crazy stuff back then. Like, I was fresh out the Army and ready to, you know what I mean? The government had my head all gassed up, ready to kill people and shit. And excuse my French, but, you know how I do that. And on your basketball topic, on your Bradley Beal and Bradley Beal, he trash truck juice, man. Like, he not even...
I was trying to be nice. I don't understand what the big deal is about, boy.
My man needs, like, you hit my man in the knees, and he done for the year. Like, if he bumped knees with anybody, he done. Bradley Beal, like, he got the magic genie in his pocket or something, man. How you get that contract, like, with them brittle-ass knees? Like, how do you get that kind of money?
Yeah, I'm like, yeah, how do you get that after they just reported 2 months ago that you are on a minutes count for the rest of your career?
Whatever offer I was going to give you,
I'm going to adjust that by how many minutes you're going to play.
I know
y'all going to be salty, too, because I'm going to throw a name out there. He's not better than Eric Gordon. I know Dev will co-sign it. He ain't better than Eric Gordon.
But anybody will argue over that? First of all, he's bigger than Eric Gordon, and I'm sure he played more defense than Eric Gordon. So that's what the argument would be. But if I need a shooting guard to score, I'm taking Eric Gordon.
I will take Eric Gordon 5 times out of 5.
Because I want my shooting guards to shoot.
He's getting up shots. And he can drive. Like, he's better than Bradley Beal.
Eric Gordon is an unknown 28 game.
The thing is, but he's brittle too. Like, he missed the glass.
Yeah, he missed a lot of games.
Yeah. He's brittle. He definitely brittle.
Yeah, like, you can't, if you, like I said, he the same thing. Like, if you bump him and he fall on one of them elbows and knees, he done. Like, he good for 35 games a year. Maxed out. So you might as well, like, hold him off until, like, May and try to get him, you know, to get hot down the stretch. Because, yeah, for real, like, you can't put him in bubble wrap until May. You can't let him run. You can't send him off no pick and rolls or nothing. Like, he just got to stand in the corner until May. All right, now you can go off the pick and roll. It's May 1st. You can't even, you know what I mean? You got to stand in the corner and just shoot jump shots until it's playoff time. You can't even get busy. You know what I mean? Like, in the second round of the playoffs, like, you, April, the playoffs are in April. You got to wait till the second round. You can't even get in the first round of the playoffs.
So you got to get him on a real good team so they can make it to the second round so he can bowl out.
Spurs on the bench and just sitting there and letting, you know what I mean, letting marinate.
All right. Cool.
Y'all did it big, man. I love this show, man. I had to go high. I'm hiding in my car right now so I can talk to y'all because my chair is hot.
We appreciate you, Cap.
All right, man. Appreciate it, man.
All right, fellas.
I'll holler at you.
All right,
we'll
take
it easy.
Yo,
salute to Corey, man.
Yo, Brad Dill, you garbage, big.
Yo, you are garbage, bitch. I'm with that, man. $100 million garbage, man. Yo, Robin Kelly is on the line right now. Rob, you got some words you want to say to be awesome, beloved?
Man, no, he's going to say them to me. He's going to say them to me.
And no, he's going to come at me.
Listen, listen. I don't make fun of y'all. I don't talk about, you know what I'm saying, Dev's Coke bottle glasses. I don't talk about the awesome Beat Boys.
What do you say about my Burberry?
Man, I'm not even saying anything.
Rob, what you say about my Burberry? Huh?
Man, nobody talking about you, though. Hey, Rob, listen, I take up for you, beloved.
You seen your head, though? Come on, man. Come on, Rob.
Yeah, you might see me all blue, all red, every day, every day. I'm 50 Tyson.
That sounds like you. That sounds like you. It don't sound like me.
Who is you? Who is you? Yo, you don't realize who's doing that. Who is you?
Yo,
who are you talking to?
Yo, me and Daddy,
you.
On the board.
I never touched it. What do you mean it sounds like me?
Yo, hey, Rob.
At least say my name. At least say it sounds like Dev. You're saying
Dev,
it sounds like
Dev.
You, like you're sure that I'm the
Dev.
One that's doing that, and I haven't done it at all.
Ever.
What?
B, I think he's scared of you, because we have let him know, like, every week that it's not us, and it's only three of us here, so he must be afraid of you or something. I don't know what you did, what kind of fear you put in this boy.
Hey, man, you saw
well,
all that
like
he was afraid of D-Bo.
I don't look like disaster.
Yeah,
but anyways, about Nate Parker, I told I go on Black Twitter. First of all, Black folk got to stop doing each other. They got to stop putting each other on blast. And a lot of people like to do that. A lot of people like just to feed off of people.
Yo,
yeah,
for the last
you know,
4 weeks, this boy done called in here talking trash, but he just said I had Coke bottle glasses, and he said we got to stop putting Black people on blast.
Yeah. This, you know what? Whatever, man, whatever. But not only that, the same people who are getting on their pocket, listen to Tupac. And remember, Tupac had a sexual was convicted
Whoa.
Of sexual abuse in that case. And I mean, and yeah, so I think so. If people want to be all the way all against violence against women, stop listening to Tupac. You know what I'm saying? Stop quoting him.
Why are you not picking up a black man? There, you could use a lot of other white dudes as an example. There, you could have used Roman Polanski. You could have used Woody Allen, but you want to pick on Tupac though. What's up with you, man?
No. I'm not picking on Pac. I'm just saying the same people. If people want to go all the way, the same people who are demonizing Nate Parker, decimating his character, decimating his reputation. Those are the same people that people got to stop.
Go ahead, get it out.
People have to stop because even in this case, in domestic cases, I can look at every case on case by case basis, right? No matter mm-hmm. if it's Nate Parker down to R. Kelly down to other rapists. I mean. If Bill Cosby or a case by case basis, or if we're gonna go by accused, by somebody being accused, look at Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton has been accused for numerous sexual assault cases dating back to the 70s, and nobody talks about him. John Travolta has, I think, men and women sexual harassment cases too. So
well,
I'm not.
But you
I'm
did,
not,
but you defend gay rights though.
Huh?
No, go ahead, man. You listening, man? Go ahead,
man. I said who? Ray Rice?
No,
go ahead with your point, Rob. I mean, you know, go ahead with your point.
What I'm saying is this. I don't like the people who are demonizing Nate Parker. If you want to support the film and not the person, I understand. But don't become demonized and decimate this guy's character if something happened 17 or 10 years ago. And by the way, to all the young players in the game, man. Hello?
Yo, what happened, Rob?
Yo, Rob! Where you guys be?
I think Rob,
Rob is out, Kelly. And made a comment about Tupac,
champ.
And he just disappeared.
Yo, they got him. Yo, the champ from Harlem Nights. Rob, we appreciate you, bro.
Rob, I got goons in Cali.
Yeah, he made a comment about Tupac, and now he just disappeared.
All right, well.
Man.
We ain't talking none about it.
All I want to say is be on the lookout for the WRS Pigskin Pick'em group. It's a $50 prize. Be on the lookout mm-hmm. for that. You will see it everywhere. We're going to put that out there.
And, you know, shout to Josh Norman for going at everybody in the league. But it's time to get out of here. Thank you, good folks, for joining us again in the War Room. Shout out to everybody in the chat room, Facebook, Twitter. People that called in and called and got through, we appreciate it. Those we couldn't get to, we apologize. Rob, we know you got kidnapped. You know what I mean? Let us know you okay. Tune in next week live right here on demand on the WRS Podcast Network. More NFL season prep, much more. So until then, listen, just enjoy your week. We'll see you right back here next time. Catch everything we do at warroomsports.com. That includes our social media, our blogs, webcasts, our podcasts, everything, warroomsports.com. Also, check out my book, Sports the Book. Go to sportsthebook.com or warroomsports.com. Until next time, everybody, don't accept mediocrity. Be steadfast in the war against ignorance, and we'll see you chumps on top.
All the blueprint.
Yo.
Every Thursday, 6 to 8, they do this. Shout out to Dez, PJ, Be Austin, Doc Bay on replay. WarRoomSports.com. Get that mobile app. If not, dial.
Call it
323 Brooklyn 0012. Woo. If you're going and you're sensitive, then oh well.
Yeah.
Physical podcast, let's talk sports. Showtime like magic in the block push.
Magic.
Listen live, push one to join in. Rip your team or listen for your enjoyment. Hip-hop dollars, pit stop and knowledge. Should be in sports credits, I ain't talking college. Five guys, no beef though. Sports are a secret, but the streets know. Belafonte, I got a G-flow. KC, royalty, I'm in beast mode.
Woo!
2 hours, get your game up. Who's the best in sports cast? You better name us.
War Room Sports.
War Room Sports, www.warroomsports.com. What? Ain't no more to it.